Welcome to the beautiful city of Marina Del Rey. We are here at the C-Suite Network Conference, and we are fortunate enough to have Virginie Glaenzer, who is the EVP of Marketing at Great Eastern Energy.
Correct.
Did I get that right?
Yes, and thank you for having me.
Thanks for being here, Virginie. And we're excited today to talk a little about B2B marketing. And I think one of the questions I'd like to ask apropos to this conference is, what is the largest challenge someone in your role has from a marketing perspective?
I think there's actually many challenges. It would be a good thing if there was only one. There's many challenges. As I was reflecting on next year, the trends, and you know, as I'm working on my 2015 plan, I was looking at a number of things. One of the things that I'm looking at is technology.
Sure.
I mean, it's been said over the past few years since the beginning of social media, technologies are evolving very quickly. There's always the latest things, and we know that we shouldn't, as a brand, we shouldn't jump on that shiny new things. But marketing becomes very technology-driven.
Yep.
And so you've got to either be passionate about technology yourself to keep up with the latest tools, or you got to have someone in your team that becomes the marketer technologist.
I love that. And can I jump on that for a second? You know, I think folks often find themselves, you know, following the random acts of technology, if you will. But ultimately, there's a miss in the definition or the pure objective of why you're leveraging that technology. So when you sit in the role that you do, Virginie, what do you define as the ultimate objective you're seeking when you're enabling these pieces of technology?
That's a great question, and I think this can also be applied to social media. We all know that the purpose is not to do social media or to embrace a new technology, but it's really connecting those things to the business objective.
Yep.
So before I do anything, I set up a goal. I set up an objective that really is connected to the objective of the company. So I work closely with the CEO, with the VP sales, to understand what do we want to achieve? What's the goal? Where do we want to be in a year from now, in 5 years from now? Once I have that clear expectation and orientation, then I can go back and say, okay, now that I know my goal and my objectives as a marketer, why am I doing social media? How am I going to be using social media to achieve those goals? Same thing, what are the technologies that are going to help me get into those objectives?
So focusing on the outcomes first.
Yes.
Okay, fantastic. Right. So what are some of the other challenges that sit at your table, if you will?
So social media, as a marketer, it's all about trials and error.
Right.
And we all know that when you launch an advertising campaign, you can't even you. Even if you prepare yourself, you have big data, you have the knowledge, you can't really know, you know, what's going to do, you know, how people are going to react to an advertising campaign, to a piece of content. Well, now, because of social media and because of how fast the world is going, you have to become agile. The same way that engineers, software engineers, are using agile in their own development process. So you don't have to wait 6 months or 3 months after the advertising campaign. You actually have the ability, if you embrace that agility skill set, to know in a couple of hours if the tweet advertising campaign you just launched is actually working.
But in working to what degree? Like, what are you measuring?
Being successful.
Okay.
So in terms of number of clicks,
brand,
whatever the objective you've set up.
Share voice.
So I think as a marketer, we need to learn to be agile. And that's not easy.
Nope.
You have to have the tools, you have to have the willingness.
An entrepreneurial mindset.
Exactly.
Right? Because there's, I think in larger organizations, especially the companies we work with, mid-market enterprise, there is very much a corporate monolithic mindset of scale and efficiency, and sometimes you got to fail fast to figure out where those wins are, if that makes sense.
Yes, absolutely. But I think it's fascinating. Now that I know that I'm actually looking for, okay, how am I going to be agile? How does that look like?
Mm-hmm.
Let's just take an example. You know, we're just launching an advertising on Facebook. How long are we going to be waiting? Should we look at an hour? Can we make the, as soon as we get the result, does that mean that we already know? We can make assumption based on numbers? You know, and how do we react? How do we change it?
You know, that's interesting. You know, you're an energy company, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you're talking about Facebook. So what are you doing on Facebook? What types of campaigns are you deploying or programs are you leveraging Facebook for?
It's funny that you're asking, because I was talking to someone recently and I was telling that person that even though we help small and large companies on the East Coast manage their energy needs through the gas and electricity procurement, the mission of the company is to educate businesses on how to save energy, how to consume less energy. And someone was saying, why would you do that? Because you're shooting yourself in the foot. We're not. That's the mission of the company. And it's really in the interest, the best interest of the customer. You know, they want to pay less for their energy. And it's not just a matter of buying the least expensive commodity, but it's really looking at the big picture. What type of energy am I using, and what can I do to reduce my consumption? How can I train my people, whether I'm a restaurant owner or I work in a property management companies? How do I train people to consume less energy? Would a LED light bulb make a difference?
Sure.
So that's what we're doing.
And speaking of training or behaviors, if you will, you're in an industry that is an older industry, if you will. How has the buyer's journey changed over the past couple of years, or even decades, if you can look back?
You know, I've been in technology for the last 20 years, so I think my experience is more on the technology side. I'm recently in the energy business, but I think it's the same thing whether you're in energy or healthcare or any kind of industry. To me, the buyers have been a lot more, or currently more educated. They're in the know. They know more. And because they know more, they already know what they want. So it means that you have to pay close attention to what they want versus what the company used to do in the past, which is just a mass communication campaign and just look at the sales number afterwards. So more educated buyers. And then I think people have a different set of expectations. It's not anymore about, I want to buy this product. It's how is this product is being made? What's the recycling program? And how does that impact Earth and society and me as a consumer?
So the values-based consumption
that's
happening right now.
Yeah.
That's interesting. So how is it affecting your organization?
Well, for example, we are seeing trends that people are concerned about energy. And we are looking at alternative energy like solar panel, technology like LED lighting. So even though the core competency of the company is about gas and electricity and the know-how how to sell and buy those commodities, we are expanding to provide services in other areas.
Okay, fantastic. And how does that educational component, the fact that your customers come to the table with more information, how does that shift the conversation when they actually connect with people in the sales department?
I think, here's the thing. So, you know, social media has been used over the past few years mostly as a new communication channel. And we can see now that brands understand that it's not a one-way communication, it's a two-way communication.
Sure.
There's a dialogue, right? And it's not easy because most brands didn't really fundamentally want to know what people were thinking because it's easier not to.
Yep.
What I'm seeing now is that, and so there has been some sort of competition over the best story. That would make the best social media campaign that would be, you know, that would lead to become one of those great brands. If you had a great story to tell, that would be, you would be one of those top brands. I think in the future, and that's what the people and buyers are requiring now and looking for, is transparency, which means that they no longer, or they got tired of that hype on the best story, the best, right?
A lot of chasing.
Exactly.
Yep.
And they're looking for transparency. Tell me something that your company is doing that I should be aware of, that matters to me. And I think the brands that are going to be understanding that concept of transparency for the interest of the buyer will win them over, will really build that relationship.
I love that. And I think that's, you know, the notion of building relationships, right? Is relevancy, is giving them something of value that they've been heard. How do you hear them at scale? How do you understand what your customers are looking for that becomes relevant at mass?
So we're using tools. That's when technology comes into play. When you have the right tools, you're able to listen, you're able to engage. We're using a social media influencer outreach called eCairn. It has an amazing engine. I know there's a number of other tools, but it gives us the ability to understand key influencers and really understand what's going on, what are the hot topics, what matters to them, what are they worrying when they wake up in the morning. And we're a small company, so it's not like we have an enormous budget.
Sure.
We have limited resources, limited budget, but there's tools out there that allows you to have a deep listening and understanding of customers.
Okay. From the role you play within your organization, what types of data and reports do you look at to understand the health of marketing within your organization?
That's another challenge for marketers, is that there's tons of KPIs.
Yep.
You can spend your day looking at KPIs no matter what you do.
It's big, beautiful graphs.
Yes, yep. Exactly. And then you ask yourself, okay, which one of these KPIs are actually actionable that I can do something with? So my team is really involved. Every month, everyone will look at the KPIs on their end, and I kind of have a whole spectrum of data of KPIs, and I look at some. So, there's brand awareness KPIs, the number of people coming on our website, and then the number of conversion, how many of those come to our site and decide to engage with us. That's one KPI that I closely keep track of. Ultimately, at the end of the day, it's the number of leads. Marketing generates leads that, and then there's qualitative data and quantitative data about the leads to make sure that that's what the sales team is looking for. But, being myself in technology for the last 20 years and being in the sales, moving from sales to marketing, I have a sales hat that is just will always be on my head.
Interesting. You mentioned the sales hat, and I've had this conversation with many folks. The term the revenue marketer, continues to grow more in vogue. And do you believe that marketing should have a quota and that they should have?
I think so, too.
Okay.
I think it would be an interesting dynamic to actually have marketers with a quota.
Because do you have a quota?
I don't.
Okay.
I don't. My quota ultimately is the revenue of the company. And I'm kind of a separate case because I used to be a salesperson.
Okay.
So I love making money, and it's part of, I'm competitive. I am who I am.
Sure.
But I think a lot of marketers love the creativity, love the messaging, the communication, and maybe they're not like salespeople. Salespeople have a very unique personality.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're not motivated by competition, then I don't think quota will...
It's not for you.
Yeah, exactly.
Makes sense. Yeah. If you had to make a recommendation to marketers who sit in a similar role, what would you say that most likely is not on their strategic roadmap that probably should be, Virginie?
Well, I'm always surprised that mobile is not across the platform. In other words, I'm looking at websites on my mobile device that are not mobile enabled.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, we are in 2014. You've got to have mobile. If it's not, I'm still blown out, blown away by the fact that so many emails are not mobile first.
Yep.
So it's mobile is like, it's a no-brainer.
So, and would you suggest mobile from an email perspective? Are there other opportunities from a mobile marketing within B2B?
It has to be mobile first.
Okay.
That's it. Whether it's consumer, whether it's business, it's mobile first. Email needs to be mobile. Website needs to be mobile. You don't have to have a mobile website. It needs to be responsive so that it's enabled for a mobile site, for mobile devices.
Sure,
but
absolutely.
It has to be mobile.
Virginie, with great Eastern energy, thank you so much. This has been a pleasure.
Thank you. Thank you very much.